Good afternoon. Welcome all to MAPICON 2020. Today we will be discussing the management of acute pancreatitis in 2020. And I am Dr. Ajesh Bansal, and I am a consultant gastroenterologist at Delhi Heart Institute. So coming to the management of acute pancreatitis, before proceeding to the management, let us define what is acute pancreatitis. Acute pancreatitis is acute or a sudden inflammation of the pancreas with or without necrosis of a pancreatic tissue. And in this lecture, what we will be discussing, first that how to make a diagnosis of acute pancreatitis, then we will discuss the likely etiologies of acute pancreatitis and what are the different etiologies which are common to our geographical regions. Then we will discussing how to predict severity of acute pancreatitis when the patient lands up to you in the ER or in your OPD. And then also, what is the severity of pancreatitis at a point of time? And then we will be discussing the initial management of acute pancreatitis in the first 48 to 72 hours. And then we'll be discussing the late management of acute pancreatitis if the pancreatitis goes on for lingers on for another few weeks time. So these are all based what I'm discussing on the recent recommendations by American College of Gastroenterology. So to diagnosis, how the diagnosis of acute pancreatitis is made? The diagnosis of acute pancreatitis is made when out of these three criteria, two are fulfilled. What are those three criteria? One is clinical pain. The clinical pain, which is a pain which is has a sudden onset in the epigastric region, which often irritates the back, which is a constant history, which is in line with a diagnosis of acute pancreatitis. So one is a clinical pain, which is consistent with acute pancreatitis. Second, serum amylase or lipase greater than 3 times, not less than 3 times, greater than 3 times the upper limit of the normal. And there is the characteristic findings on abdominal imaging. Abdominal imaging may be an ultrasound, maybe your CT, or maybe MR. We will be discussing what modality in the coming few slides. So either out of these two criteria fulfilled, we say that the patient is having a episode of acute pancreatitis. Coming to the issue of a CT abdomen, the CT abdomen should be avoided. CT abdomen with contrast or MRI is only reserved in whom the diagnosis is still unclear or the patients fail to improve after 48 to 72 hours of admission. Why? Why the CT is avoided? Because it has been found that if we do a CT in the first 48 to 72 hours, there are higher likely chances of developing a nephrotoxicity, or also there is evidence to suggest that possibly, which was a sterile necrotic tissue, that the IV contrast turned that sterile necrotic tissue into an infected necrotic tissue. So this is a common mistake which we encounter. The CT is done in the initial 48 to 72 hours. It should best be avoided in the first 48 to 72 hours, and it should only be done if the patient doesn't improve after 48 to 72 hours. Now coming to the issue of serum amylase, there is often, I see in my practice, the amylase are repeatedly done. Say on the very first day of admission, the amylase was 3000. The next day, the physician gets my medical colleague gets it done and says to the patient is 2000. On the third day, he gets 1000. Does that mean his pancreatitis is settling? The answer is clear, no. The serum amylase is only of a diagnostic value. It doesn't carry any prognostic value. So avoid getting serum amylase on every alternate day or anything. So it should only be done on the very first day and should not be repeated. And based upon the elevations or decreasing trends of amylase, we should not be basing our treatment decisions. Now coming, I will be discussing a very one case vignette with you. This is a 47-year-old male who has a history of mild alcohol intake and with no history of prior gallstones or acute pancreatitis, presents to emergency room with an epigastric abdominal pain which is radiated to the back and lipase is 500 on admission. So in this case scenario, we have met the diagnosis. There is an epigastric abdominal pain and the lipase is high. So And so these two criteria are fulfilled, and we say that the patient is having acute pancreatitis. And in this patient, just to confirm acute pancreatitis, there's no requirement of CT or MR, because as we have discussed before, getting a CT or MR may turn a mild pancreatitis into moderate or severe pancreatitis. So it should best be avoided in the first 48 hours. Now, discussing etiology, transabdominal ultrasound should be performed in all patients with acute pancreatitis to assess as an etiology of acute pancreatitis. And in absence of gallstones or significant alcohol use, get serum triglycerides. And if serum triglycerides are level of more than 1000, consider it as an etiological agent. And in patients more than 40 years of age, consider the possibility of pancreatic tumor. And in patients less than 30 years of age, consider genetic testing for hereditary pancreatitis. So coming to the case vignette, as we have said, we should be getting an ultrasound done in all patients. And in this patient, an ultrasound showed cholelithiasis with CBD dilatation with no CBD stone. So in this case, the likely etiology was gallstone pancreatitis with or without component of alcohol-induced pancreatitis. So we have discussed in this case vignette so far how we establish a diagnosis of acute pancreatitis. We have discussed this the minimal role of CT or abdominal in the first 48 to 72 hours, and we have discussed the what are the likely etiologies, and transabdominal ultrasound should be a preferred modality because it has got no nephrotoxic and it's a non-invasive measure. Now, coming to the various etiology and coming to according to the gender ratio and the age-wise ratio, the patients who are men and are young or middle age are likely suffer from alcohol-induced acute pancreatitis. Women and who are patients who are elderly, they usually suffer and biliary. They usually have a biliary cause of acute pancreatitis. I'm coming to the next question. After we discuss the etiology, we have discussed the diagnosis. Now, coming to the third very important question, when we are sitting in a periphery and handling the patient with acute pancreatitis, that is assessment of severity of acute pancreatitis at the very time the patient lands up into your emergency room. Now, why it is important? Because if we predict at the onset, it will be safe for our future, because a clinical decision is required before it has before the disease peaks, and we should be able to pick up that this patient is going to be kept with me, or if this disease is going to worsen, it should be preferably referred to a higher center in which there is a multi-specialty backup. So severity prediction is required at the very onset. But there is also classification for acute pancreatitis in which it is required to say that this patient is having mild pancreatitis, moderate or severe pancreatitis. So I will be discussing the very first question, assessment of severity of acute pancreatitis on the day of onset of pain. Because we usually have two questions, whether this patient will develop severe acute pancreatitis, and second question, whether this patient will die. So now there are various methodologies which are I am discussing the tools which are easy to calculate. ER clinic call as a biceps score. What is biceps score? B stands for blood urine nitrogen more than 25. I stands for impaired mental status. S stands for evidence of systemic inflammatory response syndrome. A stands for age more than 60, and P stands for left pleural effusion. Any score more than 2, that is 3 or higher, indicates a higher mortality, and a score less than 2 indicates a lower mortality. And how do you define SIRS? SIRS is defined by a high temperature or a hypothermia, a tachycardia, a tachypnea, or leukocytosis or leukopenia. Any 2 out of these is defines SIRS. So any patient who's having a biceps score more than 2 is likely having a severe acute pancreatitis, and he is a patient which needs a referral to a higher center at the time of admission. And a score and a patient having a score less than 2 can be at a peripheral center and can be given a clinical management at your own center. Now predicting there's another score, what we call as a harmless acute pancreatitis score, and which is usually done within first 30 minutes of admission, which is when you palpate the abdomen, there's no rebound tenderness. If you get a CBC, it shows normal hematocrit values and there is normal. If these all three criteria are fulfilled, then also the patient is likely having a mild acute pancreatitis, and this patient doesn't have a severe pancreatitis. And in this case, the patient may not need a referral to any higher center. Now, coming also, there are other factors which may be not be part of this these criteria is if there's a presence of comorbid disease, if the patient is having CKD, if the patient is having coronary artery disease, or there is a significant diabetes. These are all the patients who may develop severe pancreatitis or ultimately mortality. These all the patients need to be considered. So to summarize, patients with high severity of initial presentation and presence of end organ failure like shock, AKI, altered mental status, respiratory failure, ARDS should be admitted to an ICU. That's what I wanted to say. Now coming to the next thing, classification. Atlanta classification. Atlanta classification, which was revised in 2012, in which other than the mild and the severe category, there was another category introduced, what we call as a moderate category. What is the difference between a mild, moderate and a severe? Mild pancreatitis is there's no organ failure and there's no local complications. Whereas severe pancreatitis, I'm skipping the moderate, but the severe pancreatitis is a one in which there is an organ failure, persistent organ failure more than 48 hours. Now coming to the moderate category is a one which is in between, meaning thereby it is having local complications or it is having a transient organ failure less than 48 hours. Why there is a difference? Because mild pancreatitis has got a low morbidity and low mortality. Moderate pancreatitis has got a high morbidity but a low mortality. And a severe pancreatitis has got a very high mortality and of course a higher morbidity. So that is a difference which needs to classify so that is the reason why we are classifying these pancreatitis into three categories. So coming to the next part, now defining the local complications, how we define the local complications. Now there's in the revised Atlanta classification, now there was an often term used, pseudocyst, there was another who was using a pancreatic abscess, phlegmon. So lots of terminologies were being used. Now there is a revision in and there is a unified mechanism in which we can define all the moderate all the pancreatic collections in our patients. Now acute pancreatitis collections are broadly divided into initial two categories. One is interstitial pancreatitis and second is necrotizing. Interstitial pancreatitis means there's edema of the pancreatic parenchyma or extra pancreatic parenchyma. Necrotizing means there is a significant necrosis, say more than 33% in the pancreatic tissue or extra pancreatic tissue. So this is defined by two categories, interstitial and a necrotizing one. Now coming to the interstitial pancreatitis, any collection which is less than 4 weeks, we call it as acute peripancreatic fluid collection. If it resolves, it's well and good, but if it doesn't resolve, it is called as pseudocyst. So pseudocyst terminology is to be used only in presence of interstitial pancreatitis and after 4 weeks of onset of acute pancreatitis. It should not be used in a patient less than 4 weeks, and if there's any collection in presence of interstitial pancreatitis less than four weeks, we should call it as acute peripancreatic fluid collection. Now coming to the second category, necrotizing. Any collection in necrotizing is called an acute necrotic collection. If it resolves within the first 4 weeks, it is called an acute necrotic collection. If it doesn't resolve after 4 weeks, we call it as wall of necrotic collection. which may be infected or which may be sterile. So now the terminologies of, again I'm coming, phlegmon, pancreatic abscess has all been obsolete. Now the new terminology is called as wall of necrotic collection, and it should only be used in presence of necrotizing pancreatitis, and a pseudocyst terminology should only be used in presence of interstitial pancreatitis, not in the presence of necrotizing pancreatitis. So as I've discussed this before, mild pancreatitis has got low morbidity and low mortality. Moderate pancreatitis has got a high morbidity with a low mortality, and severe acute pancreatitis, of course, has a high mortality with a high morbidity. Now coming to the management. Now what happens in the acute pancreatitis? When there is acute pancreatitis, there is a lot of extravasation of fluid to the peritoneum with decreased intravascular volume, and ultimately hematocrit rises. When the hematocrit rises, there is a decreased pancreatic perfusion, which increases further pancreatic necrosis and leading on to third space loss, increase all inflammatory mediators like tumor necrosis factor, trypsin, elastase. And so if this is a vicious cycle, and the only mechanism to halt this vicious cycle is with fluids. So early and aggressive IV fluid hydration must be initiated. If there is a severe hypovolemia at the time of admission, bolus IV fluid should be given, and then keep a maintenance rate up to 150 to 250 or up to 500 ml per hour IV fluids. And what kind of IV fluids? Isotonic, which can be normal saline or ringer lactate, but there's now the evidence is coming up, the ringer lactate is a better fluid than normal saline. And how to start early? Early, that means as soon as possible. And that should be in the first, most beneficial effect of fluid is in the first 12 to 24 hours. And what is the goal? To decrease our blood urea nitrogen. So coming to the same case, Vignette, that patient was given an IV fluid hydration at a rate of 250 to 500 ml per hour, with a monitoring of blood urea nitrogen every 6 hourly, with a goal of IV hydration to decrease blood urea nitrogen in the first 12 to 24 hours. So, but there are different drawbacks of aggressive fluid therapy. The patient may develop abdominal compartment syndrome, or he may develop ARDS. So there's now evidence coming up that you may give a fluid of up to 10 ml per kilogram per hour. That is considered to be a better fluid criteria rather than giving a more aggressive fluid in order to avoid abdominal compartment and ARDS. So as I said, targets for fluid resuscitation should be adequate urine output, stabilization of blood pressure and pulse rate, normalization of central venous pressures, and a modest decrease in hematocrit, 15 to 25%. Now coming to the next issue of the manymeric acute pancreatitis is the feeding. Acute pancreatitis represents a hypercatabolic metabolic state, which is marked by high caloric and high nitrogen demand from the acute inflammatory and reparative process. And there was an initial notion that NPO is better. Then came the phenomena nasogastrial feeding is better. Now there is a significant evidence that nasogastric as well as nasogastrial feeding are comparable in efficacy and safety. So in other words, do not delay feeding if the nasogastrial feeding is not present. And IV or parenteral nutrition should be avoided. That enteral feeding is not only to meet caloric requirement, and it also prevents infectious complications, because it reduces, the enteral feeding reduces the bacterial translocation into the mesenteric circulation, thereby preventing the onset of infected pancreatic necrosis. And timing as soon as possible, but in the first 48 hours it should be initiated. So in this case, we did, because this patient was able to have a peroral take within 48 hours, nothing was put in. So you have to speculate that if the patient is a moderate or severe pancreatitis, moderate severe category of pancreatitis, those are the category of patient in which you may require putting in a nasogastric or nasogastric feeding tube. In patient with mild acute pancreatitis, the patient may not need any kind of supplementary feeding tubes. So role of antibiotics, this is a very controversial topic, but routine use of prophylactic antibiotics, like if the patient has severe acute pancreatitis, so the routine prophylactic use with no documented site of sepsis is not recommended. And use of antibiotics to prevent progression of sterile necrosis to infected necrosis is also recommended. And because patients with acute pancreatitis often and early have fever, but this doesn't necessarily mean that patients have infected necrosis. There is existence of infected pancreatic necrosis. Why? Because these are the patients who may need hospitalization for many weeks to many months. When the patient doesn't require any antibiotics, at that point of time, you may avoid giving them an antibiotic in order to prevent an onset of fungemia, because long-term use of antibiotic may have an adverse outcome or may lead to fungemia or even Clostridium difficile colitis. So role of antibiotics again, so when to give. When we are thinking of infected necrosis, that the patient is fails to improve after 7 to 10 days of hospitalization, and either FNA with gram stain or culture, or empirically treat with antibacterial antibiotics. And routine antifungal therapy is not recommended. Now, role of surgery. When should the patient be referred to a surgeon? A mild acute pancreatitis with gallstones, perform cholecystectomy before discharge. And necrotizing acute pancreatitis with gallstones, delay cholecystectomy until inflammation subsides. So the role of surgery, asymptomatic pseudocyst or sterile necrosis do not warrant intervention regardless of size or location. So if there is a 15 centimeter pseudocyst and the patient doesn't have any symptoms of pain, vomiting, or patient doesn't have a fever, jaundice, or any bleed, that patient doesn't need any intervention. But if the patient having a 6 centimeter size or 5 centimeter size pseudocyst, which is causing him a lot of trouble like pain, fever, that is a patient who may require some kind of intervention. So asymptomatic pseudocyst or sterile necrosis do not warrant intervention regardless of size or location. And in stable patients, drainage of infected necrosis should be delayed for at least 4 weeks to allow formation of wall of necrosis. Now, management of wall of necrosis, antibiotics alone has a significant role. If there's no response to antibiotics, you may have a percutaneous drainage. If the patient is still unfit for surgery, we may go for endoscopic necrosectomy. I will just show you some video of endoscopic necrosectomy. Or if there is still, or the patient is having a right paracolic collection, and endoscopic necrosectomy is not possible, or percutaneous drainage is not possible, then there is anterior or retroperitoneal approach by a surgeon or by a video assisted or a small incision based left retroperitoneal debridement. So overall success appears to be more than 50% in avoiding an open surgery. So if we follow a step up approach by giving standalone antibiotics, no response, percutaneous or radiological drainage, no response, endoscopic drainage, laparoscopic drainage. So, and in the end, open surgery, you may avoid 50% of the open surgeries. So that's what the message is. So I'm just giving you this video, like this patient was having an infected necrotic collection, and in which it was giving an bulge on the duodenum, in which we punctured the duodenal wall and we entered into the cavity and we dilated with the so now the balloon is being put up, and we say we are now dilating the balloon, and we can see after the balloon is this whole cavity is dilated, there is and drainage of the pus-like material into the duodenum, and this is forming a natural fistula between the duodenal wall and the cystic cavity, and there we put in the stent. So this is one kind of things in which we can decrease the morbidity of the patient and definitely the mortality of any patient. Now this is what I'm showing you, an endoscopy nephrectomy video in which this was an again a collection, infected necrotic collection, which was causing an impinge on the stomach wall, and in which again we had dilating with a balloon. And after we dilated with the balloon, we entered in the cyst cavity, and we see there is a lot of necrosome. And in this necrosome is picked by a grasping forceps, and we are picking up the necrosome, and assistant helps you in having a good grasp of the necrosome. And this necrosome is slowly pulled out and ultimately thrown into the stomach cavity, and there you can repeat these things and ultimately can drain a lot of necrotic material. Although this may require multiple CT, maybe 4, maybe 6, depending upon how morbid how large and how bad the disease is. So these are the things which we can do endoscopically. And drain all these bad necrotic collections. So there are new novel therapies which are I'm giving you a short brief. Like there is a study by China, like in 2012, like they used continuous venous venohemofiltration or peritoneal dialysis, which was performed within the first 4 to 6 hours from hospitalization. Although reported results seem promising, that level of all cytokines dropped substantially sooner, the time to relief to dominant PN was shortened, CT severity scores decreased, Apache scores decreased, and incidence of organ failure decreased, thereby having improvement in the overall outcome. But this study has not been replicated later on, and has not. So we are still not sure whether these therapies are really working or they have outdated. So to summarize, the early and the accurate diagnosis of acute pancreatitis is crucial. The early treatment of acute pancreatitis with aggressive IV fluid hydration saves lives and is most beneficial in the first 12 to 24 hours. Routine prophylactic antibiotic use is not recommended for acute pancreatitis unless presence of infected necrosis is established clinically or by final aspiration, and mild acute pancreatitis due to gallstones warrant cholecystectomy before discharge, and step up approach in a multidisciplinary care for management of infected necrosis is highly beneficial. Thank you very much.